rose-colored glasses are off, it's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 37 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I have the pleasure of chatting with owner of Impact Branding Consulting, Natasha Davis. Impact Branding is a brand development and PR management consulting firm equipped with consultants, marketing specialists, executive coaches, project managers, technology experts, and professional development specialists. Their niche is helping healthcare reach higher heights. They help companies to establish, grow, and relaunch operations with excellence through the use of strategy and implementation. Their goal is to take business owners and companies down the path of least resistance. So without further ado, let's hop into our interview with Natasha Davis. Natasha, thanks so much for joining me.
Absolutely. I'm looking forward to it. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So you are a branding strategist and you have 10 plus years of experience, but nobody starts at the top. Everybody starts somewhere. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug and how did you become enchanted with marketing and branding?
Oh, wow. So honestly, it happened kind of weird, to be honest, because my first profession, I'm a registered nurse by first profession, been in the healthcare field over 18 years and specialized in emergency and trauma. However, maybe about 13 years ago, I started seeking a lot of or finding interest in different things like marketing, process in marketing, how to get customers or the marketplace to pay attention to you. And so my brain kind of gravitated more towards that a few years ago. And while working in the emergency room, you know, we'd be in the middle of a trauma or, you know, something like that. And, you know, we'd kind of be wrapping up and we're talking about different things. And I'd be saying, well, you know, have you thought about doing this for business? Or how did you look at marketing or, you know, stuff like that. And so, you know, doctors and other nurses be like, what do you know about business? I'm like, I know enough to give you an answer. And so kind of started there. And as I kept growing, I realized that I really enjoyed business and marketing. And at that time, I self-taught about marketing and business. And when I got to about maybe 5 or 6 years in, I wanted to have accelerated knowledge. So I went ahead and went back to school and got my master's in business and marketing. And I started to dive deep and to uncover the true depths of what branding is, because there was a huge misconception between branding and marketing, and people kept putting it all together. And so I kept wondering, where I asked my marketing professor, are these things used, you know, are they the same? So after asking my professor and they said, no, that branding and marketing is not the same, I decided, let me go find out what the difference is. And so that's where I started diving deep to really research and understand the true depths of what branding is and understanding how it plays a role in business. And so that's what I've done. I've become a expert in branding. That's where we are.
Excellent. So you are probably the first trauma nurse I've ever interviewed. So Lord forbid I get hit by a car, I know who to call.
Yes.
That is awesome. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that sort of shiny veneer come off? And it's like, okay, it's time to get down to brass tacks. Sort of like marriage, right? Like when you first meet this person, everything's new and different. They can do no wrong. Then you figure out that they snore like a dying moose and have all these other quirks. So when you transitioned from nursing into branding, when did it get real for you?
Wow. Okay. So of course, you're absolutely right. You know, when you first cross over, you're like, I can conquer the world. Everything is awesome and everything is beautiful. That phase hit me, stayed with me for a couple of years. And I usually tell people the first 4 years in business was pure hell, because it was. That's where I knew that I needed to get it together and stop playing marketing, playing shop, playing business. And so when I was about the fourth year, I realized that this is not funny anymore. And this is not all games. This is serious. And by the time I got to year 5 or 6, I really buckled down, because it was at that point that I started to get very strategic and truly understand what it really requires to be a business owner, and what it requires to actually provide service and branding. How do you really get results, not just surface results, but get hardcore results? How do you take your skill set and your knowledge, apply it to a client and serve them well? You know, when we're helping clients save $70,000 a year and $80,000 a year by implementing strategic branding, that is really what I had to get down to. And so now today, when I look back and I said, this is the heart, you know, we had to go through the fire. Now today, when we're helping companies to really scale and we're helping companies to capitalize and to mobilize their brand, really defining, what does that mean? What does it really mean to mobilize a company's brand and to enhance their performance and to make them more efficient? And today, when I step back, I look at that, that's what I've done over the years, and that's what I've learned. And so now I can help companies do that. I tell people, you know, before as a nurse, I saved lives in the trauma room. Now as a branding strategist, I save companies.
I love that. I absolutely love that. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future, because one of the areas of marketing that I follow is mobile/connected devices/the Internet of Things, whatever you want to call it. Mm-hmm. And sort of the default example that everybody gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered via Amazon drone. Right. Mm-hmm. And in that scenario, that's what they call a closed loop system, because you don't actually have to leave the house. Everything is fully automated, just like the Jetsons. And there has been concerns in the marketing community, like, okay, when that actually comes to pass, are we all going to have jobs? So, putting your future goggles on, what do you see the role of marketing and branding being when we enter the future of the Jetsons and everything is on autopilot?
You know, here's the thing, you know, when we talk about branding and marketing, branding and marketing is a personable, it's a touch personable thing. And so if you take the connection away from marketing and branding, you don't have marketing and branding anymore. Marketing is built on connecting with individuals, sharing my story with someone in some form of a capacity and asking them to come and into my world, come into my business. And so marketing is a conversation. And the way that I'm seeing things happening, we're going that way very digitally, very, you know, Jetsons era. However, there's going to be a shift and there's going to be accommodations, because if you isolate the persons from the message, from the true touch, feel message, then you no longer have a qualified message. You don't have that anymore. So in order to really to look at the future of it, what I see, in my opinion, as what I've been watching the trend, I've watched the trend from we come face to face to I only interact over some digital component or through a computer or through social media. And now if we pay attention, it's coming back full circle. People are like, I miss human interaction. I miss talking to people. I miss sitting at a table breaking bread with individuals. You don't close deals via email. Somebody has to hear someone's voice or see the whites of someone's eyes to close a deal. And those moments of where digital is probably going to be 100% consumption, that thought process has been interrupted, because people are realizing I still need to touch, feel the individual. I still need to interact. We are human beings. We're not robots. And as human beings, we need interaction. You know, to be locked in your office all day and never engage with a human being outside of your home or whatever, that doesn't work. Business isn't moving. It's painful. And so the way I see the future of digital marketing and overall branding is, yes, we have to embrace the new technology. We have to embrace the new era, but we still have to continue to remember the touch points and that we are still human beings. And that interaction is going to be a requirement now.
Amen. Amen. The pendulum always swings back the other way, and human beings, we are essentially social creatures. So I tend to agree.
Yeah.
So you, Gary V, and Brian Solis, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference, Ann Hanley or whoever, you're all chilling at the bar after a conference having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from professional digital marketing, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Ooh, now you're gonna put me out there live, huh? Listen, here's how I look at it. I can tell you what I believe is lacking. The first thing that's lacking is true skill. That's the first thing that's lacking. And understanding of in the professional industry, understanding of what really is happening. When you have an individual that says, I do branding, and you said, okay, great. Tell me what you do in branding. And they say, well, I build websites. That is not branding. That's not branding. That is a component of it. That is like the image. I'm just giving you the image. However, if you don't write the content and have the story behind it and understand the mission and really look at the structure and the infrastructure and the architecture of the company's brand, then all you're going to have is a cookie cutter website. What's missing is knowledge amongst the professions. Also, and to some extent, and I know some of my fellow industry professionals may cringe at this, but what also is missing is integrity. It's not right, some of the things that's happening in the industry. It's not right that you'll have someone say, I'm going to do your social media marketing. I'm going to charge you $1,500 a month, but I'm only going to post 2 times a week. And then when you find out that I haven't been doing my job, I'm going to say, I'm sorry because I had a lot more clients on the books and so forth and blah, 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 blah. Integrity is missing. We have to stick to our word. If we say we're going to market you and we say we're going to get more customers to you, then do it. And what at all costs, do it. If you have to lose sleep, do it. Because if you onboard a client and you take their money and you promise them, I'm going to bring more people to your company, I'm going to help you to realize your vision even better, because that's what it is. Bringing more customers to the person's company is helping them to realize their vision. This is their passion. It's their baby. And when in the marketing industry, when we don't maintain integrity and we take someone's money and we don't deliver on it, it is the worst feeling in the world, because now we lose trust. And so that is the thing that I have seen. I have gotten clients that have been so hurt and harmed by other marketers because they spent a lot of money. Marketing costs a lot of money. All forms of marketing. I mean, it can be up 30 to 50% of the budget if you're not careful. And when a company, small, medium, or large, expenses all of this money and they get zero return, they're so afraid that either they do one of two things: they try to do it themselves and they make a mess, or they don't do anything at all and their business starts to go dormant and it's just a mess. They're afraid because they're like, I can't spend any more money and I didn't get what I want. So if I sat at the table, I would want to look at that. The way I would want to enforce shifting and ensuring that we do maintain knowledge and integrity is that we need to make sure that those that are in the profession, the few of us in the profession that are holding true to what we've agreed to do and how we've agreed to help companies, we need to stand strong. And sometimes you need to call some people out. We need an egg is an egg, a rabbit's a rabbit, a bird is a bird. We need to call it what it is. And as that, we need to band together and really enforce, how do we continue to move the company, the industry forward without making stuff up?
Amen, amen. You can't see me because this is all audio, but I'm over here shaking my head. I might need medical attention afterwards because I got whiplash now, because the Agency Management Institute, run by Drew McClellan, and they teach, you know, agencies how to run more professionally. They release a report every year, and in the, I believe it was the 2015 report, they reported that a full 36% of companies with marketing budgets between $500,000 and $4 million a year said that they fired their agency because they did not get what they paid for.
That's right.
And that goes back to what you were saying. So for a very long time, people were faking the funk and they were out here, you know, jading customers. And I've ran into it myself. I get somebody who's just so damaged by the process. Like, it takes a lot of nurturing to kind of, you know, walk them back off the ledge. So
I cannot agree with you more in that. And we as a marketing community, we need to do a lot better. And like you said, calling people out and driving these people out of the industry because they're hurting everybody as a whole. Amen. Okay, stepping off my soapbox because you know
I agree. You brought it. I have to go. I just got to push it 1 minute. Like it really just makes me just curl when I hear someone say, "Oh, I do your branding," and I say, "Okay, great. What kind of branding you do?" "I do social media." Mm-hmm. "Sweetheart, that is not branding. That is not branding. That's marketing. You know, oh, I do your branding. What do? I do logos. That's not branding. That's collaterals." And if we don't know what the architecture of the brand is, and you don't know what the mission and what the true direction of this company is, creating a logo, putting up a website, and doing social media without intention and without strategy is not going to evolve into anything. You know, the days where people's like, "Well, I'll do your social media and I'm going to get you 1,000 followers." Well, you got a brick and mortar business that is in this dedicated place, and that's the only place they provide service to. But the person goes and gets followers in like Zimbabwe. Well, they're never coming to patron your business ever. So you're not going to get any results from it. And so when I talk to people, I'm like, "Listen, when we're building out your entire campaign, don't worry about the quantity. Look at the quality. I'd rather have 100 followers on your social network that engage you and that will patron you, as opposed to having 1,000 followers and only 2% of them are even close enough to engage you or patron you." So we have to fall back a little bit and come off of this, "Oh, I got 5,000 followers," but you're not making any money from them. You don't do anything. It doesn't convert. They're just a bunch of people sitting there, you know, buying followers and buying all this stuff. It doesn't convert because it's a bunch of numbers. And society, we got to stop with the, "Oh, we got 5,000 followers." Yeah, but what is it doing for your bottom line?
Absolutely. Speaking of quality over quantity, myself and my co-author, we wrote a book last year in 2016 called Beyond Buzzwords. And by far, the marketing buzzword of 2016 was influencer marketing. It was all over the place. All these articles, new podcasts popping up. And those in the space warned that it was only a matter of time before we got a spectacular train wreck in the influencer marketing space. I'm not talking about just a regular train wreck. I'm talking about mushroom cloud, debris everywhere. And we got that recently with Kendall Jenner and the Pepsi fallout. But before that, we got one courtesy of one PewDiePie. And for those of you who don't know, PewDiePie is like the original YouTube rags to riches story. He went from just somebody with a YouTube channel. Now he makes approximately $4 million a year. He was the first YouTube channel with a billion. That's a billion with a B followers or views rather. And he previously had relationships with Disney and Maker. And the reason I say previously is because PewDiePie fashioned himself as an amateur humorist. Yeah. And he decided to take shots at the website Fiverr.com and the outrageous things that you can do for get people to do for as little as $5, such as, you know, buying followers and buying views, etc., that you were mentioning before. However, the way in which he chose to go about this was by hiring these people to say and do anti-Semitic things. Mm-hmm. And the fallout was swift and immediate. Disney immediately dropped him. So did Maker. But there was a little bit of backlash from PewDiePie's following from Disney for dropping him. So my question is twofold. How do you see this fiasco affecting influencer marketing as a whole? Chris Brogan made a very interesting point on the Marketing Companion podcast that the way in which millennials use language is fundamentally different from how older generations use language, and what offends us doesn't necessarily offend them. And also in this ever salacious internet with clickbait and alternative facts and everything else, do you think that those looking to, you know, grab their 15 minutes of fame will be emboldened to be ever more outrageous? Or do you think that this will have a chilling effect on the whole influencer marketing craze?
All right. So that's like a really loaded question. So I'm going to see if I can answer it the best way possible. So let me kind of go from the front and work my way back, or kind of give a comprehensive answer. The thing about it is society or the marketplace is dictating what people are doing. You go on to, let's take for example, you go on to, like you said, you know, you have someone that says, I'm gonna run amok. I'm just gonna make all this noise and I'm gonna talk about a company. And then you have, like you said, the millennials, they think it's hilarious. Hilarious. It's a great thing, ha ha ha. But then you have the other generations, multiple other generations, that says, wait a second, that's kind of offensive, or that's not right, because why? Now you're impacting the livelihood of a company, or you're crossing over into character assassination. Okay, now you can might be get yourself a lawsuit. So the other generations are looking at it from that perspective. And then you have the economies. Like, say, for instance, you got the gig economy. The gig economy is thinking about it. This is my bread and butter. This is my livelihood. So I don't take that lightly. Okay, because the gig economy is feeding Fiverr. And so you have all these different perspectives. Now, what will happen is the millennials are going to be commenting. They're going to be like LOLing and ha 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 and keep it rolling and all this other stuff, right? The gig economy is either going to be so annoyed, they're not going to say anything, or they're going to say something and say, you know, this is inappropriate or whatever. And no, it becomes this conversation online that goes nowhere. So in terms of that, because like I said, it's a pretty loaded question. In terms of that, we in the marketplace start to dictate what's going to happen. You have people that will see a good source. Like, say, for instance, let's take Facebook Live, for example. OK, you got Facebook Live. And you have certain persons or parties on Facebook Live that use it for good. And then you have other ones that use it for pure foolishness. And then you have other ones that use it for bad. But you have this one platform that if people would use it, the benefit that it was designed for, it would be a good thing. But you have all these different varying uses of it because there's no control over it. So when we think about the, you know, things like that, and we come to the backlash of it and all that, we as the individuals in the market space, we have to start dictating how conversations are going to go. And sometimes either you respond, you don't respond, you have to know where you're going with that. But again, people have given so much emphasis to the millennials and given this, like they've separated them, like they're a completely different human race, a different human being, that it doesn't even make sense to me anymore. Am I even on the right track? Where am I?
No, I tend to agree. I'm a millennial, and I'll be frank, I don't like the term because, like you said, there's levels of professionalism. There's a lot of different levels, and I get where you are going. So absolutely, yeah, I would say you are on the right track, and it needs to be said because, you know, yes, we the demographic that's coming up, but there are several other generations, and as we mature, you know, because I'm an older millennial, I'm 32 as mm-hmm. of this recording. As we mature, you know, we're not a monolith. I'm very, very different from a 17-year-old. You know what I'm saying? Right. But we're both millennials.
Right.
So I tend to agree. So we're going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Natasha Davis. So stick with me.
We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multi-millionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon.
And we're back. So, Natasha, without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means, express yourself, because candor is the whole point of this podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news fallout controversy after the results of the 2016 U.S. presidential election? Because just to back up for those who may not know, in the last 3 months of the U.S. presidential election in 2016, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, I mean that these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality whatsoever. It was not a simple matter of spinning the facts one direction or another, which all news does, right? MSNBC leans left, Fox News leans right, but there were no underlying facts to be spun. Like they were made up in their entirety. They were fairy tales. And following the election, Mark Zuckerberg was like, no. It's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the results. And then in his February 2017 open letter, Mark Zuckerberg kind of conceded that fake news has outstripped Facebook's current ability to govern it, and they are in the process of rolling out third party verification and artificial intelligence to kind of curb fake news on their platform. And this has sparked a very interesting debate within the marketing community, because you have some who are strictly First Amendment, is like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And then you have others who are like, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you're away traveling on business, and while you're gone, some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool, and one of them drowns.
Right.
You put up a fence. They were trespassing. It doesn't matter. It happened on your property, and you are ultimately responsible. So again, without getting political, staying more on the, you know, marketing slash branding side in terms of how it affects the ecosystem in the marketplace, where do you stand on the whole fake news fallout and control debate?
Listen, I'm going to, like you said, I'm going to keep it straight and candid. I'm going to keep it straight. First of all, I agree with you. I put my fence up. I'm a business. You're on my property. I know you're on my property. I didn't do anything about it. Someone gets hurt. What am I going to say? Oh, it's not me. Doesn't work like that. So I agree with you with that. Secondly, I think it's from a marketing standpoint, this is where I talk about knowledge and integrity. As a marketing professional, we are supposed to vet information before we even broadcast it, use it, or support it. As a true professional, we are supposed to gather data from credible sites, credible material. So when we haul off and start pulling stuff from anywhere, or piggybacking on somebody said something and you start sharing it, piggyback it, you put it with your clients and all that stuff, and we never vet it, the marketing professional is just as responsible for encouraging the rise of fake news. if we as marketing professionals follow the profession, we would have vetted the information from a credible site. You have the Society of Professional Journalists. We have credible organizations. We have credible media outlets that we are supposed to gather our data from and do our research. A pure Google search is not research. And this is where I come again with that same thing, integrity in the industry, and also the ability to understand what we're doing, implement knowledge. Because the only way that fake news can spread is if you have professionals spreading it. It's one thing for the layperson to say, hey, did you hear that so-and-so had 5 babies? It's one thing for the layperson to do it. It's another thing for a person of influence, a marketing person, someone in the so-called media space through other outlets, to take that information and to share it to the masses. The layperson that just has their little circle cannot mass share information, right? And I know somebody may disagree, but hear me out. I myself cannot post enough information to trend anywhere. Even if I posted 100 times a day, I cannot allow my verbiage to trend. I can't do that. If I say to my friend, hey, can you go ahead and share this on your little network? They can share it. But you know who takes it into media and into the masses and onto platforms? Other marketing people in media, because they're hungry and bloodthirsty for any kind of news. Because some people believe good publicity, bad publicity is publicity. So let's spread it. And so we have to look at who is standing behind this push. Facebook should have had these systems implemented already, that if you're going to share information that is considered news, there should have already been filters in to pick that stuff up and stop it before it got wild. It's like putting out, you know, weed killer. We spray weed killer to stop the spread of weeds.
I dig it. That's probably the best analogy that I've heard so far, spraying weed killer. And I'm going to steal that. I'm going to give you credit twice, then it's mine. So large corporations have just recently gotten serious about digital marketing. For a very long time, they kind of treated it like a fad, waiting for it to blow over. But now that they've actually, you know, put some muscle behind it, that ad spend is disproportionately going toward Facebook and Google. Like, it's not even close. Those two entities are gobbling up 85-90 cents of every dollar spent on digital ad spend. And the laws of supply and demand dictate that as there's more competition for a limited amount of ad inventory, that the prices are going to rise. And we have seen that in the research through WordStream and eMarketer and a lot of others, that the cost per click has steadily been rising over time. And so what can theoretically happen is that we could soon enter a space where you have the haves and the have-nots in terms of digital advertising, because you have the, you know, your Coca-Colas and your Nikes throwing around their elephant dollars and making digital advertising less viable for small business. So my question is, do you think that that will happen, where we have a future, a near future, where every other post is, you know, powered by Pepsi? Or do you think that the internet will remain true to its disruptive roots, and when we do, you know, get saturated by big business, that something else new will crop up to disrupt that?
They're gonna be fighting for space. They're gonna be fighting to get in. Everyone's gonna get in arms, and there's no space, and it's only gonna be the ones that are the quickest and the sharpest, and who knows and who doesn't know, right? The persons that have creativity and ingenuity are gonna go over to the right side. They're gonna go and climb up the 15 steps, climb over the beam, get in the lifeboat, get down, and get away. And they're gonna go and save themselves. So when we have individuals that are going to flood the online space, the digital marketing space, it's the marketer that is going to get super creative and apply ingenuity and go back to the basics and say, What are the fundamentals and the foundations of marketing? Because digital marketing, though it is very robust right now, it's still very new. And it still has to follow the flow of basic, foundational, and the fundamentals of marketing. People are trying to take the easy way out. And that's what it is. Marketing is getting lazy. You're taking the easy way out. No one's putting much work into marketing. There's no more work put into it. And it's only those that are sticking to the foundations and the fundamentals of marketing that are going to scale. Those that are going for the quickest way, they're not putting any brain action into it. They're taking the easy way out. You know, that's where the hurt is going to happen, because you're going to put billions and billions of dollars into something and it's not going to translate the way that the individuals think. As opposed to if they stuck to the fundamentals of marketing and branding, and kept it that way, they would see more profits and more credibility.
Your analogies are amazing. If no one's ever told you that, like, no, seriously, you break it down in such a way, it's very easy to understand. Probably you're the best, probably, since I had Jay Akunzo on. Jay Akunzo is really good from the Unthinkable podcast, but your analogies are just stellar. They're absolutely stellar. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate you taking the time. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, but I'm steering it in a very particular direction, and I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. So in my professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a brand or an agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas. Even though you could absolutely make the case that they're professionals because they operate at such a high level, it's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. So in terms of professionalizing yourself, there's sort of three main tracks that most people follow. The first is to just roll the dice on Google. But contrary to popular belief, rooting out the really good information does take a degree of skill. You might land on convincing to convert. You might end up doing Amway. Like, who knows where that Google rabbit hole goes? You can do what we did, which is to go back and get degrees in marketing. But I had to borrow the better part of $60,000, so it was expensive. Plus, it was time consuming. My degree program, even though it was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And in the digital marketing ecosystem, 30 months is several lifetimes. But by far, the most prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best in class practices is through conferences and seminars. The issue there is that even though in aggregate, it's a lot less expensive than going back to school, you gotta have that money up front, right? So we just recently ran into each other at the Hope Global Forum annual meeting. It was $1,250 for those tickets, right? That did not include your flight, your hotel, Uber, back and forth, eating out for how many days. So if you were coming from, you know, New York or California someplace, you're talking $3,000-$5,000 all in. Right. And some of these conferences like a ClickFunnels or something like that, they have a VIP coaching / inner circle / whatever you want to call it, some kind of coaching and training program. And those can be upwards of $10,000. And so after you factor all of that in, depending on, you know, whose conference you're going to, after you matriculate through the funnel all the way, you might be looking at $15,000, $20,000 out of pocket, which again is less expensive than getting a degree, but you gotta have the money up front. So what ends up happening is that, you know, you don't tend to see a lot of people from our demographic at these things. So now that I've finished rambling, I'm trying to crowdsource, if you will, a way of professionalizing yourself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to borrow against your life insurance policy so you can attend a conference, right? So now that I'm done rambling for however many minutes, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have. Your food and shelter, taken care of. But all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right. You are college freshman broke, Natasha. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
That is a phenomenal question, and I love it. All right. So the first thing I would do, can I leave the area? Is there anyone else around me? Can I go?
Yeah, you can go wherever you want to go. You still got all the skills and experience. You all just right. got 30 days to make something happen and all no right. cash.
Well, good. So the first thing I would do, if I want to build these relationships, I would definitely source the high level conferences that are happening, because I want to see where the thought leaders are going to be, because I still want to capture the knowledge. And instead of becoming an attendee there, I would request to be a volunteer, because I want to be in the space. I want to be in the space where the knowledge is being transformed and where it's also being transferred. So I want to be in that space. I want to be within earshot. So I would volunteer, but I would strategically volunteer as well, also to be maybe like a greeter for the actual speakers. That's number one. And I would put that on my list of things to do. And I would do it at several conferences throughout the month. The next thing I would do is, with my laptop, I would track down my thought leaders and I would go to their sites and evaluate their material. So they have audio tools, they got downloadable resources that are free. I would attend their webinars online, the ones that are free. And I would keep up with their obviously we're in the current age, so it's social media. I would follow their specific page to see what they are saying and where they have been. What are they talking about? And that's my point where I would go from. The next thing I would do, again, is those leaders that are published, those leaders that align with those professional grade organizations, I would then align with those professional grade organizations. So I would get real hardcore, applicable, and accurate information. And that's how I would build and fill my knowledge vault, so that I didn't have to sell my firstborn or mortgage my house to do so. I would go to the colleges and I would specifically see if I can either get a scholarship or something to sit in that classroom free of charge. So I would track down grants, apply for grants, so that I can get covered to go either to the conferences or to the college to get the degree, to get the knowledge. But I would probably more so grant for the conferences at the present time. Because if I go to the college, I'm going to get very surface information. And I want high level information because I only have 30 days.
I hope you guys were taking notes, because you just got a master's class. Natasha, this has been tremendous. Please take a moment. Give us your social media handles. Tell us any upcoming events you got going on. Where can we get some more of you?
You can get some more of me by going to impactbrandingconsulting.com, impactbrandingconsulting.com. When you get there, all of my social networks are there: Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, YouTube, all that good stuff. You'll also have the opportunity to get a copy of my recent newly released book called BeUnleashed, Unleash Your Millionaire Mindset and Build Your Brand, where we're talking about the real deals of branding and how to scale yourself in the world of using branding and how to be unleashed. And I'm really honored to have been on this platform to transfer some knowledge during this particular platform. And I appreciate you having me on. And again, I'm Natasha Davis. They call me the Chief Visionary. And you can find me on impactbrandingconsulting.com. And that's where you can get all the information that you need from me. I'd love to connect with you guys.
There you have it, folks. ImpactBrandingConsulting.com and that new book, Be Unleashed. If you can't tell already, she brings the noise. So do yourself a favor and pick that up. You are very welcome. We'd love to have you back anytime. You got something else coming up. And again, thanks so much for taking the time.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.